Welcome everyone to our worship today, and a very happy Epiphany to one and all. I know we're not exactly at Epiphany anymore, we're a few days beyond, but this is the first Sunday after Epiphany, and we're still in the Epiphany season, so that's going to be very much our theme for this worship. And we begin with a prayer. Let us pray. Brightest and best of the sons of the morning, Lord Jesus, we come to praise you. You are the brightest light in our lives and in our world. You shine in the darkness. You have banished the darkness from us. You are the best of all possible saviours, of all possible lords. Son of the morning, you are the dawn light for us. Your coming brightens our day. So, Lord, we turn to you now, brightest and best. And we pray that you will dawn on our darkness. Come into our lives and make yourself known once more. Shine your light upon us. Banish the evil that lurks in the corners of our life. Bring it into the light that it may be forgiven and dealt with and our lives may be cleansed. Shine your light on the way ahead so that we may see clearly where we are to go in our lives. Dawn on our darkness, we pray. Lend us your aid. We need your help, Lord Jesus. If we are even to worship you, we need your help, because our words are not enough. Our feelings, our thoughts, these are only the smallest part of what we should offer to you. So, Lord, help us now as we worship. Lift our thoughts to you, fill our hearts with praise. And so we come to gaze upon your glory and your brightness, and in a moment of silence, to offer our worship. Lord Jesus Christ, like the wise men following your birth, teach us to search for you until we come to faith, and then to go on searching just as eagerly and wholeheartedly to discover more of your will and purpose for our lives. Continue to surprise us with the wonder of your love and the awesomeness of your grace. And so may we know you and love you better each day, to the glory of your name. Amen. Amen. And we're going to sing our praise. You've already had a hint of the hymn that we're about to sing, Brightest and Best. Thank you. if we're thinking of the theme of Epiphany, the gospel lesson that we are almost inevitably led to is Matthew chapter 2. But as this story is so familiar, I'm going to read it in a slightly different translation, the Message. Not so much a translation, it's what is called a paraphrase, because it's not a literal word-for-word translation. It's a single author, a single translator, who has tried to capture the essence of the story, but put into slightly more colloquial English. Matthew chapter 2, verses 1 to 12. After Jesus was born in Bethlehem village, Judah territory, this was during Herod's kingship, a band of scholars arrived in Jerusalem from the east. They asked around, "Where can we find and pay homage to the newborn king of the Jews? We observed a star in the eastern sky that signalled his birth. We're on pilgrimage to worship him." When word of their inquiry got to Herod, he was terrified, and not Herod alone, but most of Jerusalem as well. Herod lost no time. He gathered all the high priests and religion scholars in the city together and asked, "Where is the Messiah supposed to be born?" They told him, "Bethlehem, Judah territory. The prophet Micah wrote it plainly. It's you, Bethlehem, in Judah's land, no longer bringing up the rear. From you will come the leader who will shepherd rule my people, my Israel." Herod then arranged a secret meeting with the scholars from the east. Pretending to be as devout as they were, he got them to tell him exactly when the birth announcement star appeared. Then he told them the prophecy about Bethlehem and said, "Go find this child. Leave no stone unturned. As soon as you find him, send word and I'll join you at once in your worship." Instructed by the king, they set off. Then the star appeared again, the same star that they'd seen in the eastern skies. It led them on until it hovered over the place of the child. They could hardly contain themselves. They were in the right place. They had arrived at the right time. They entered the house and saw the child in the arms of Mary, his mother. Overcome, they kneeled and worshipped him. Then they opened their luggage and presented gifts: gold, frankincense, myrrh. In a dream, they were warned not to report back to Herod, so they worked out another route, left the territory without being seen, and returned to their own country. Thanks be to God for his word. I looked up the word Epiphany in a dictionary. I still like to use the old-fashioned dictionaries and not just look up the meaning of the words online. And we have had for many years, the shorter Oxford English Dictionary, not the full one, the shorter one, volume one. And this defines Epiphany in this way. Firstly, it says it's the festival commemorating the manifestation of Christ to the Gentiles in the persons of the Magi, observed on January the 6th, the 12th day after Christmas. But then there's a second, slightly more general meaning, a manifestation or appearance of some divine or superhuman being. Now, I was a little surprised, I must admit, because I use the word Epiphany when I use it at all, and if it's not in a very specific after Christmas context, I would use it to talk about just a general realization, a sudden Inspiration. I heard it used on television the other day. Someone said they'd had an epiphany, and it was nothing to do with appearance of some divine or superhuman being. It was an insight into their own nature. So I've got a second dictionary. I was curious what a more up-to-date dictionary defined it. And it does have a slightly more general meaning: a sudden manifestation or perception of the essential nature or meaning of something. So not just divinities and godlike creatures, but the essential nature or meaning of something. It's that light bulb moment. It's that moment when it goes ding like that, and you realize something that you'd not noticed before. But what was the nature of the epiphany to these wise men, as we traditionally call them, the magi, the scholars from the East? What was it that they suddenly realized and became aware of? When Matthew tells us the story, he doesn't give us anything in the way of insight into their thoughts and what was going on in their minds. He tells us what they did and what they said, but we don't get anything about how they felt or how they thought, except for one moment where Matthew tells us they rejoiced with exceeding great joy. I think the way the message puts it is, I've lost the pace now. They could hardly contain themselves. Same idea. In English, rejoicing and joy, the same root. They rejoiced with joy. And in Greek, the two words are actually put next to each other. So you get that repetition. Very close. It sounds even a little bit clumsy in Greek. They rejoiced with joy that was exceedingly great. But it's not just Matthew telling us they were happy, but they were really happy. They were chuffed. They were over the moon. They could hardly contain themselves. That was that one moment. And we'll come to that in due course. But what was it that they realized? What was the nature of the epiphany? Now, I have to admit, most of what I'm going to talk about is speculation, because Matthew doesn't tell us really what was going on. But I like to think that I can imagine more or less what was happening in the minds of these wise men. And I think there were four moments of epiphany, not just one. But four moments when they realised something. And we'll have a look at those four, because they may help us with an epiphany of our own. So the first epiphany actually was before the story even began. They refer back to it. We saw his star in the east and realised that this meant that a new king of the Jews was born. Now, what that star was, we can speculate, and I'm sure you've heard theories put forward. A comet, maybe, a supernova, a conjunction of planets, a bit like we had recently, where Jupiter and Saturn were very close together in the sky, something that doesn't happen very often. But whatever it was, in the understanding that they had, They interpreted it as meaning that it was something to do with the Jewish people, it was something to do with a king, a ruler of that people, and it was something to do with birth, that this new king had just arrived on the scene, a newborn king. And they decided to do something about it. They decided to go and investigate and meet the new king and offer their worship. Now, I'm not going to argue that astrology is a good thing. I think astrology is rubbish. The idea that the stars determine our fate and can speak to us about what is going on in life, I find that very hard to believe. But I can believe and do believe that God speaks through nature. And in some strange way, on this occasion, God managed to get the correct message across to these men. And still today, God speaks through the natural world. Sometimes science and religion are presented as in opposition to each other. If you're a scientist, you can't be religious. If you're religious, you can't really believe in science. That's rubbish. There's nothing incompatible about science and religion. In fact, many of the early scientists were very devout people who saw the world as God's creation. And in order to understand God better, they thought they could do it by understanding the world better, by understanding the way nature works, the way things tick. So whether we're talking about biologists or physicists or chemists, any scientist who explored the nature of the world that we live in order to try and get insights into God, that was science and religion working hand in hand, as indeed they ought to continue to do. Looking at the world around us can give us insights into the nature of God. And they're not always comfortable. We see beauty around us. We see majesty and power and awesomeness in the world around us. We also see danger and pain. This is a world where we have a virus that can run rampage and ruin lives and nations. It's a world which has its volcanoes and its earthquakes and so on. So what does that say about God? Well, at the very least, it tells us that God has put us in a dangerous world. He's not surrounded us with cotton wool and protected us from all perils. But he's put his people, the human race, into a world where there is struggle and where there is danger and where we need to work together to overcome those things. I don't pretend to understand why we live in such a world, but we do, and it speaks to us in some way of God. Plus all the good and positive things, the rainbows, the sunsets, the things of great beauty, the crashing waves on the ocean that reminded us of God's of power and glory. Nature cries out to us with the voice of God. He speaks like that. And the wise men's first epiphany was when they believed that God was speaking to them through something in the heavens and revealing something to them about what was going on in the world. Epiphany number one. But it wasn't enough. In fact, it only gave them a little bit of the story, and they ended up in the wrong place. They thought, okay, let's go to the land of the Jews. That's the obvious place to go. And if we're looking for a king, let's go to Jerusalem, the capital city. Let's see where we can find this new king there. It was the wrong place, but they did find some help there, because Herod summoned the scholars, the religious teachers. There's a clumsy phrase that the message doesn't use about the people's chief priests. It wasn't even his own entourage who were helping him here. He had to go outside the palace, as it were, to the ordinary people and the chief priests there and work out what's going on. Herod did make a connection between the king of the Jews and the Messiah. They came looking for the king of the Jews, and Herod thought, this is to do with that prophecy about the coming Messiah. And therefore he asked, where's the Messiah going to be born? And they told him, in Bethlehem. The Messiah was a descendant of David. He was naturally going to be born in the same city that David was born in, Bethlehem. And they quote the prophecy. So the wise men's second epiphany was that they were not looking for a political ruler, but they were looking for some religious figure, a Messiah, a savior, someone who was more than just an earthly ruler. And that epiphany, that moment of insight, came through the scripture. The star started them on the journey, but it was the word of Scripture that actually honed it down to exactly where they needed to be and who it was they were looking for. And that was another moment of revelation. We need Scripture to help us understand God. The world in itself is not enough. I've already indicated that actually it's a dangerous world. So what is that saying about God? We need to turn to Scripture to help us understand the nature of God. And that reveals to us God's love for us. It reveals to us God's plans for our future, God's work of salvation. And even Scripture's not easy. We may need help, like Herod needed help, like the wise men needed help. We might need people who have more insights than us, who've spent more time studying the Scripture and can unpack it for us and help us to understand. But the written word of God helps us understand his nature. For the wise men, it was Epiphany number two. For us as well, the more we study the word of God, the more we can understand about him. And then we come to Epiphany number three, and this is the moment where we get the rejoicing with great joy, exceeding great joy. And this was in the appearance of the star again. We often get the wrong idea about the wise men following the star. We tend to assume from carols and from pictures on Christmas cards that right from day one, there was the star and they've set off and followed it. No, they saw the star in the east. That was what started their journey. When they got to Herod, they didn't say, "We've come here because of that star up there. Look, that's the one that means the king of the Jews is born." They said, we've seen the star when we were back in the east. We saw it and we set off. But now, when they're heading to Bethlehem, because they've been told that's the place they should be, they see the star again, whatever it is. It's there in the sky and it goes ahead of them and stops over where the child lies. Now, think about that for a moment. When Jupiter and Saturn were due to be very close together, my wife and I did go out one evening to see if we could actually see this for ourselves. And she thought we ought to be somewhere high up. Well, there's not anywhere very high in Lincolnshire. So we went up to the footbridge over the A17. And just being a little bit higher up, we were able to see the conjunction of planets. It was quite impressive. You could see them there in the sky, low down, close together. I did try taking a picture, but it was a rubbish picture. It was just little bits of light and didn't mean anything. But from our perspective, the two planets were over the Holdingham roundabout, the little one, not the very big one on the main road, but the little one nearby. That's where it was over. When we came back home, we actually found that you could still see the conjunction of planets. We didn't need to have travelled further away. You could still see them, but they were above Tesco supermarket. The point here is that where the star, whatever it was over, depends on your point of view and where you're standing. It wasn't just the wise men saw the star over the place where the child was, but from their perspective, the star was there. In other words, this star was actually guiding them and them personally to the right place. Other people coming from different directions or viewing the star from other places wouldn't have seen the same thing. But the star was for them. And it's no wonder, as they realised that they were filled with great joy. They realised at that moment that they personally were being guided. This was not just a sign in the sky that was open to anybody to interpret, but it was something that meant something to them. Right now, right here in this place, this is where the child lies. There's the star, there's the place that you're heading for. It's not clear whether it means the town of Bethlehem or the actual house. I don't quite know. Interpret it the way you want. But certainly it was a personal message. And that filled them with joy. And no wonder. Do we get anything like that epiphany in our lives? Do we ever feel that sense of joy at knowing that God is speaking to us and it's personal and he has a message, a sign for us? I'm sure that many who are watching this, if you're of my age or round about there, you will remember the days in the past where it was quite a common thing to have a big rally with a visiting evangelist like Billy Graham or many others. These things have gone out of fashion now, and perhaps quite rightly, I'm not sure that they would quite work in the same way that they used to work long ago. But some people were critical of those big rallies and said it was all about emotion and people were caught up in the emotion of the event. And yes, they were, but sometimes you need that impetus. There were people at those events who came having learned something of God. They'd admired the beauty of nature. They'd seen God speak through nature. They'd read their Bibles. They'd heard the stories. But it didn't quite click that it was personal, that God was speaking to them. And it was in those moments of deep emotion where they realised, this is for me. I need to respond to this. That they were filled with joy and came forward in their droves often to give their lives to Christ. There's nothing wrong with that. Joy is a powerful emotion. And it was one that the wise men felt then. And it's one that we feel maybe not as often as we'd like, but from time to time, when we realise that God is still speaking and speaking to us. And in this time of lockdown, well, we need joy. We need to remember that God deals with us personally. He's not just sending a message that any old person can pick up. He wants to talk to us. He wants to help us, each one of us, in our lives. So that's epiphany number three. The wise men realise God's guiding us. He's taking us to the right place. How wonderful. And the last one that I want to talk about, epiphany number four, they enter the house and they see the child in the arms of his mother, Mary. And they worship. Now notice some of the language here. The house, the child. We're not talking about a baby lying in a manger anymore. If the star heralded the birth of Jesus, by the time they actually managed to get to Bethlehem, he would have been not a baby, maybe a toddler. Certainly Herod, having found out the exact time the star appeared, wanted all the children under 2 years old put to death. So he too recognised we're talking about a young, very young child, but not a newborn baby who had only been born 24 hours previously. We're talking about a child in a house. And what did they do? Well, they worshipped. They didn't at that moment think to themselves, this is odd. It's just a normal house. We are coming looking for the Messiah. And what do we see? A child in a normal household. This can't be right. They didn't say to Mary, have we come to the right place? Is the somewhere next door that you've got a better Messiah? This seems too ordinary for us. No, they recognised in that ordinary family that God was present in Jesus Christ. Here he was. And they worshipped and they offered these really rich and expensive gifts as part of their worship. The moment of epiphany was discovering that God was present in the ordinary. And this perhaps is a message that we need more than anything in this time of lockdown. We are spending much longer than we normally do in our homes. Some of us have hardly been out of our homes for months, the best part of a year. We've been confined to just staying at home, doing ordinary things, living ordinary lives, routine every day, and yet this is where we meet God. Jesus is present with us in these ordinary moments. We don't need to find the big, spectacular, dramatic things. Jesus is present in our homes, in our houses, in the ordinary family relationships that we have, in the everyday routines that we have. Jesus is present there with us. That, I hope, can be our moment of Epiphany. My prayer for you who are watching is that you will have those light bulb moments, ding, where you recognize something extraordinary is happening. And it might be in the world of nature. May you marvel at the world of nature. May it fascinate you, and may it lift your spirits. You may find it in Scripture. My prayer is that you may see God in the Scriptures, and that you may understand him as you study them and as you learn from others who've studied them better than you have. You may have those moments of deep emotion and recognition where you feel God is actually speaking to you, and it's coming alive, and it means something personal. But ultimately, my prayer is that even in this everyday situation that's likely to be going on for a long time yet, where we stay in our homes and where everything is just routine to the point of frustration and boredom, even here, God is present and Christ will meet with us. May that be a moment of insight and revelation for you. Amen. We're going to sing just three verses now of another Epiphany hymn, As With Gladness Men of Old. Let us pray. Lord God, we bring to you now our prayers for the world we live in, for the people we love, for our nation and for others, as we continue to struggle against hard times, as we continue to struggle with difficult decisions. Lord, bless us and bless those we love. We pray for good health. We pray that you would work with the doctors and nurses and all the medical profession as they seek to bring health, not just in conquering the COVID-19 virus, but in all the other ongoing ways in which people need healing and support in their difficulty. Lord, bless our health services and give them the skills they need and the energy they need. And at times of great stress and great pressure, be with them. Help them through, Lord, that we might know your healing touch in our lives. We pray for our nation and for wisdom for those who lead us, that as the days and the weeks go by, that right decisions can be made that will help to suppress the spread of the virus, that decisions will be made that will help to protect our economy and protect lives and livelihoods as much as possible. Lord, give wisdom to those who govern us as they struggle with very difficult decisions, very difficult choices. May they know the right moments and the right decisions to make. And we pray for other nations across the world. Each nation is fighting this pandemic in its own way, and some nations have other issues, other important issues that they are wrestling with. Again, we pray that wisdom and cool heads may prevail, and that wherever possible, negotiation, talking, loving one another, respecting one another may triumph over hatred and antagonism and bitterness and division. Lord, bless our world, we pray. And we pray for ourselves and for others who are finding life is very hard and are not looking forward to the coming weeks where nothing is going to change. Lord, bring us through those times. Bring us through to better times. And in all of this, may we discover that you are with us, and may we have that deep joy in our lives, that your presence transforms even the dullest, even the darkest, even the most difficult of situations. Bless us, Lord, we pray, in the name of Christ. Amen. And let's join in the Lord's Prayer together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. May now the light of Christ shine upon you, and the blessing of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, be with you evermore. Amen.